Hi friends, welcome you all to this crash course on modern India history. Till now we have discussed modern India chapter wise. Now we are going to consolidate the whole modern India history in a very limited amount of time. Okay, so what are the highlights of this video? Because there are many crash course available in the market. So how we are differing is, first highlight is most of the crash course video starts from the revolt of 1857 and ends in 1947. Okay, but now we are going to trace from the later Mughals, that is from 1707 to 1947. That is the first highlight. The second highlight is this video will be in full in English. Okay, we will not be going in Hindi or any local languages. That is the highlights. So before going into this video, there are some important notes. First note is, since it's a crash course, I'll be somewhat fast, so please bear with me. And second thing, I'll not write everything on the board because that will consume more time. So that also you should bear. But some important events and personalities I'll mention in the board time and then. So that is the notes and highlights. And without delay, we'll go into this crash course on modern history. So as I told, we'll be tracing out from the later Mughals. Okay. So it starts from 1707. Okay. Aurangzeb died. Okay. So this death of Aurangzeb was made a confusion in the Mughal dynasty and who was to ascend the throne. So the 65-year-old Bahadur Shah ascended the throne, and we'll see about the Bahadur Shah. What was his relationship with the Marathas, about the Punjab, that we'll see. What are the relationship? First, with the states of Amber and Marwa. These two are the states of Rajasthan, and in Amber and Marwa there are confusions. Okay, in Amber, Bahadur Shah wanted Jai Singh to be replaced by Vijay Singh, and in Marwar he wanted Ajit Singh to surrender. Okay, but later Bahadur Shah realized that he was making mistake and he wanted to make peace with these two rulers. But the main demands of these two rulers were to get high ranks like Mansabs and Subhadas. The ranks of these Mansabs and Subhadas were their only demands. But that demand was not accepted by Bahadur Shah. Okay, that is with these two rulers. Next with the Marathas. Okay. With respect to Marathas, Bahadur Shah did not recognize Shahu. Who is Shahu? Shahu is the grandson of Shivaji. Okay. And Bahadur Shah did not recognize Shahu as the ruler, and he led your Shahu and Tarabai to fight for the throne. Okay. Tarabai is the daughter-in-law of Shivaji. Okay. These two are fighting for the throne. So in short, Bahadur Shah is not having a good relationship with the Marathas, and also the only demand of Marathas is to collect the taxes. Okay. What tax? Taxes Sardeshmukhi and South. Okay. South is a normal tax of 25%, and Sardeshmukhi is like a special tax of 10%. Okay. Bahadur Shah allowed the Sardeshmukhi, that 10% I told, no, that Sardeshmukhi was allowed, but this South was not allowed. Okay. By Bahadur Shah. That is with the Marathas. With respect to Punjab, when Guru Gobind Singh, a ruler called Guru Gobind Singh is there, he was maintaining peace with Guru Gobind Singh. After the death of Guru Gobind Singh, Banda Bahadur was placed at the throne. With respect to Banda Bahadur, Bahadur Shah did not have a good relationship with Banda Bahadur. For example, in 1712, the main fort of Punjab, Logar, was captured by Bahadur Shah, but it was again recaptured by the Punjab, by the Sikhs. Okay. So with respect to Punjab also, he had a frustrated relationship. But with respect to your Bandela chief, that is your Chatrasal and Jat chief Chavaraman, he was having a good relationship. So with Marathas, bad relationship. With Punjab also, bad relationship. But with Bandela and Jat chief, he was having a good relationship. Okay. So what led to the failure of Bahadur Shah? Okay. The main failure is the promotion of Jagirs. Okay. He was promoting Jagir. Jagir is nothing but related to the Jagirdar system. So what is this Jagirdar system? See, peasants are there at the lower level and the ruler is there at the top level. So the ruler will impose the tax and the peasants are the farmers. Okay. Your peasants are going to pay that tax. So what happened by this Jagirdar system is a middleman will be placed in between the ruler and the peasants. The middleman will be there, and these peasants should pay the tax to the middleman, and the middleman will pay the tax to the British. So that was a three layer. Okay. So what happened is, this middlemen, they are known as Jagirs, they began to impose huge tax on the peasants. Okay. Additional tax, what the ruler is saying, if the ruler is saying 25% means they will collect 30%. Like that, they are adding more pressure on the peasants, and that led to the failure of Bahadur Shah. Okay. In 1712, actually Bahadur Shah died. Okay. That again led to the confusion as to who to ascend the throne. So next, who ascended the throne is, I'll write here, okay, who and all came. First we saw about the Bahadur Shah. Next, who ascended? The Jahandar Shah. Jahandasha ascended the throne with the help of Zulfikar Khan. Okay, with the help of Zulfikar Khan, he ascended the throne in the year 1713. Okay, 1713 is the year, with the help of Zulfikar Khan. So this Zulfikar Khan, this personality, okay, he was having the real power and Jahandar Shah was not having the real power. So he was made as the Wazir. Wazir is the prime minister. Okay, he was made as the prime minister and actually he was only acting. Okay, so what are the things done by Zulfikar Khan? Zulfikar Khan, the first important thing is he abolished jizya. Okay, jizya was abolished by Zulfikar Khan. Jizya is nothing but a tax on non-Muslims. Okay, that was abolished by Zulfikar Khan. And with respect to Ajit Singh, you don't know, ruler of Amber and Marwar, they were made as the respective governors of Malwa and Gujarat. Their demands were accepted. Office was given. Okay, during Bahadur Shah, they were asking that demand, but that was not given. But Zulfikar Khan gave that demand, and they were made as the governors. Okay, so that is with respect to that two rulers. And with respect to Marathas, what happened is, Bahadur Shah did not give the right to collect tax, but Zulfikar Khan gave the right to the Marathas to collect the tax. Okay, so how this happened is Daud Khan Panni, okay, personality called Daud Khan Panni was the commander in chief of Zulfikar Khan in the Deccan. Okay, he made a treaty with the Marathas, and by that treaty they were allowed to collect the tax, but on one condition. That condition is very important. What is that condition? Is Marathas cannot collect the tax directly from the people. Okay, Mughals will collect the tax and they will transfer it to the Marathas. Okay, that was the condition with respect to Marathas. And with respect to the Punjab, he was maintaining the same relationship, a frustrated relationship with Banda Bahadur. With respect to your Bandela and Jat, he was maintaining good relationship. That was with respect to Jahandar Shah, that is Zulfikar Khan. Okay, so what led to the failure of Zulfikar Khan is a thing called Ijara or revenue farming. So what is this revenue farming? Revenue farming is nothing but a land is there. Okay, this land, day by day, it is not giving good results. Productivity of the land has become very, very low. Means this land will be transferred to a third party. Okay, in short, granting of land to the third party on lease. Okay, on lease, a third party will take this land and they will cultivate. Okay, and they will actually pressurize the peasants. Okay, that led to the failure of this Zulfikar Khan. And in 1713, that was a confusion. Okay, Jahandar Shah is not the man of the moment at that time. Zulfikar Khan was the man of the moment at that time. So that was a crushed relationship between these two. Okay, at that time, the opportunity was made right by who? By Farrukhzir. Next came the Farrukhzir. Actually, Farrukhzir is the nephew of Jahandar Shah. Okay, actually Jahandar Shah and Zulfikar Khan was fighting. Okay, Farrukhzir made that opportunity as a right moment and he ascended the throne with the help of Said brothers. With respect to Said bros, okay, so who are the Said bros? Abdullah Khan and Hussein Ali Khan Bara. These are the Said brothers. These Said brothers were known as the king makers of modern India history. Okay, so with respect to Said brothers, and actually, this Said brothers were the man of the moment, and Farrukhzir was not given that power to rule. Okay, so what happened is there was a frustrated relationship with these two. Okay, with Farrukhzir and Said brothers. In the year 1719, the Said brothers killed Farrukhzir. Okay, he was killed, and Muhammad Shah was made as the ruler by Said brothers. So with respect to Said brothers, we'll see what are the things done by Said brothers. Two main important things were done by Said brothers. One is jizya was abolished. Jizya is the tax on non-Muslims was abolished, and a tax called pilgrim tax was also abolished by this Said brothers. Okay, so with respect to the Marathas, we told Bahadur Shah did not give the right to collect tax, but Zulfikar Khan gave the right to collect tax, but with one condition. But Said bros without any condition. Okay, the Marathas were given the right to collect the tax directly from the people. Okay, in return for this favor, your Marathas will provide a battalion of 15,000 soldiers to protect the Mughal territories in Deccan. Okay, that was agreement made between the Marathas and the Said brothers. Okay, and with respect to Marathas, and what was the failure? What led to the failure of Said brothers? Same thing, revenue farming. That led to the failure of Said brothers. And actually, I don't know, Said brothers made Muhammad Shah as the ruler. Muhammad Shah and Said brothers are not having a good relationship. Okay, same thing is continuing. Okay, here Jahandar Shah and Zulfikar Khan was not having good relationship. Here Farrukhzir and Said bros were not having good relationship. Now Muhammad Shah and Said brothers are not having good relationship. Okay, because why is Said brothers were having the real power? Here Zulfikar Khan was having the real power. So that led to the tussle. And finally, Muhammad Shah, with the help of personality called Nizam-ul-Mulk. Okay, Nizam-ul-Mulk and Muhammad Shah, they both combined and assassinated the Said brothers. So Said brothers were killed and Muhammad Shah was again made as the ruler with the help of Nizam-ul-Mulk. Nizam-ul-Mulk. Okay. So in the year 1722, this Nizam-ul-Mulk was made as the Wazir. Wazir means a prime minister. Nizam-ul-Mulk was made as a prime minister. And in the year 1724, what happened is, actually Nizam-ul-Mulk was a brave person and he was in a very good, he wanted this empire to develop. Okay. But Muhammad Shah was not at that time, not at that mood and all. He wanted to plunder the, plunder from the peasants, like that he was in a good mood. So Nizam-ul-Mulk tried to some extent to make this empire, to make the emperor as at a developed state, but he could not do that. Okay. So finally in 1724, he got very vexed actually and he walked out of the throne. Nizam-ul-Mulk by the year 1724 walked out of the Mughal emperor and he founded the state of Hyderabad. Okay. So this 1724 marked as a death knell to the Mughal emperor. Okay. So that is with respect to later Mughals. Actually, when Nizam-ul-Mulk walked out of the throne in 1724, that signaled the death knell of Mughal emperor. Okay. So what happened is, two important things there after 1724, and personality called Nadir Shah and Ahmad Shah Abdali. Who is these rulers? Nadir Shah was a ruler of Persia, that is Iran. Okay. Ahmad Shah Abdali was a general of Nadir Shah. Okay. So now Mughals are there. Okay. But what to say, they are not having that much power. When Nizam-ul-Mulk walked out, that signaled that okay, Mughal emperor were losing the power and they were just existing. And the Marathas are there. Okay. When Mughal was slowly deteriorating, Marathas got a good mood that okay, we'll go to the north and we'll capture everything and we'll get into the power. That was the mood of Marathas. Okay. So what happened is Nadir Shah fought versus the Mughals at Karnal, a place in Haryana, in the year 1739. And Ahmad Shah Abdali fought versus Marathas. That is the third battle of Panipat. What is the year? 1761. So what about the first, second battle of Panipat and all? That you will see in the medieval India. Okay. So in the year 1761, third battle of Panipat versus Marathas. And Marathas' dream of acquiring the whole territory of India was crushed by this third battle of Panipat. And the Mughals were also totally crushed by Nadir Shah at Karnal. Okay. So this Nadir Shah and Ahmad Shah Abdali was very important. Okay. So what happened to the Mughal emperor at last? Finally, what happened is they were existing. Okay. But not with huge powers, but they were simply existing. So who are the Mughal emperors after that? Okay, so after the invasion of Nadir Shah and Ahmad Shah Abdali, they were totally crushed. Okay, the Mughals were totally crushed, but they were simply ruling. Okay, who are the rulers? Shah Alam II, related with Battle of Buxar 1764, that I'll deal. Okay, with respect to Akbar II, one important point to be noted here is Akbar II only gave the title of Raja. Okay, to Ram Mohan Roy, we are calling us Raja Ram Mohan Roy. No, that title of Raja was given by Akbar II, and Bahadur Shah II is related to revolt of 1857. Okay, so with the end of Bahadur Shah II, the Mughals were totally crushed. Okay, so later Mughals, we started from Bahadur Shah and we are ending with Bahadur Shah II. Okay, so that is the end of later Mughals. So next we'll go to the autonomous states. Okay, so with respect to autonomous states, the first autonomous state was Hyderabad. I don't know. Nizam-ul-Mulk walked out of the throne in the year 1724 and founded the state of Hyderabad. Okay. In 1748, Nizam-ul-Mulk died and after that, Hyderabad was fell to the British. Okay. What happened to Carnatic? Actually, Carnatic was, first of all, the Nawab of Carnatic was living at the mercy of Nizam of Hyderabad. But later, he made independent. This Nawab of Carnatic was made as independent. But finally, to some extent, this Nawab of Carnatic was active and playing with the British. But finally, he also fell to the British. Okay, so that's with Hyderabad. Next, an important autonomous state was with Bengal. Okay, so this autonomous state of Bengal was founded by two personalities. One is Murshid Quli Khan and Aliwadi Khan. These two important personalities related with Bengal, and Murshid Quli Khan was followed by Shujauddin. He ruled till 1739 actually. Murshid Quli Khan was followed by Shujauddin, and Shujauddin's son called Sarfaz Khan. Shujauddin's son Sarfaz Khan was killed by Aliwadi Khan. Aliwadi Khan killed Shujauddin's son Sarfaz Khan, and he ascended the throne. Aliwadi Khan. Okay, so Aliwadi Khan was ascended to the throne and he was ruling, and to some extent he was managing with the British. Finally, he also fell prey to the British, and Alibati Khan was followed by an important personality called, I'll write here, Siraj ud Daula. Okay, Siraj ud Daula. Alibati Khan was followed by Siraj ud Daula as the Nawab of Bengal, and Siraj ud Daula is related to the black hole episode. Okay, black hole episode is nothing but that was a very interesting event in a room. Okay, that was there are no ventilations in that room. Siraj ud Daula made some 50 English officials to stay there, and they were suffocated and they died. Okay, so that led, this Siraj ud Daula's black hole episode led to the important battle, that is the Battle of Plassey. Okay, so about this Battle of Plassey and Battle of Buxar, we'll study in some 2 minutes. Okay, so that is the Bengal. It was founded by Murshid Quli Khan, Alibadi Khan, and these things happens. Finally, it ended with Nawab of Bengal, Siraj ud Daula, in the Battle of Plassey. Okay, that is with Bengal. Next, we'll go to Awadh. The next autonomous state is Awadh. Awadh, what is Awadh? Awadh is a modern day state in UP. Okay, so with respect to Awadh, it was founded by a personality called Saadat Khan Burhan ul Mulk. Saadat Khan Burhan ul Mulk in the year 1722. Okay, I'll write in short Burhan ul Mulk. Okay, he was followed by his nephew Safdar Jung, and Safdar Jung was followed by a personality called Shuja ud Daula, was the son of Safdar Jung. Okay, so Burhan ul Mulk followed by his nephew Safdar Jung. Safdar Jung's son was Shuja ud Daula, and Shuja ud Daula was related to the development of a city called Faizabad. Okay, he was very much related to that city of Faizabad. Shuja ud Daula. Okay, this Shuja ud Daula is related to the Battle of Buxar. Okay, so don't confuse the name, it was very similar. With respect to Bengal, it is Siraj ud Daula. So since we have discussed about the autonomous states of Bengal and Awadh, some two important battles are related to this autonomous states of Bengal and Awadh that we'll see. Okay, one is the Battle of Plassey in the year 1757. Okay, so Nawab of Bengal, Siraj ud Daula's black hole episode, that led to this Battle of Plassey in the year 1757. So Nawab of Bengal, Siraj ud Daula is on one side, and the British Robert Clive, under Robert Clive, is on the other side. Okay, so the officers of Siraj ud Daula like Manik Chand and Mir Jafar, they were actually bribed. Okay, before the happening of the war, officers like Manik Chand and Mir Jafar and Jagat Seth, these officers were bribed by Robert Clive, and before the war. Okay, so on that war day, actually this Battle of Plassey just existed for one hour or 2 hours. Within 1 hour or 2 hours, Siraj ud Daula was completely surrendered, because all the officers were actually bribed by Robert Clive. Okay, so that is with respect to Battle of Plassey between Siraj ud Daula and Robert Clive. Okay, so what happens with Battle of Buxar? Battle of Buxar, actually this Battle of Plassey ended with the Treaty of Ali Nagar, a treaty called Treaty of Ali Nagar. By this Treaty of Ali Nagar, Mir Jafar was placed as the Nawab of Bengal. Okay, that is with Battle of Plassey. In Battle of Buxar, what happened is, Mir Jafar's son-in-law, Mir Qasim, was replaced in Nawab of Bengal, and he was not having good relationship with British. Okay, Mir Qasim was not having good relationship with the British, and he wanted to dethrone this British. So he made a tri-party alliance. Okay, tri-party alliance, first is Mir Qasim, Nawab of Bengal, and Shah Alam II, that is the Mughal. We saw about the Mughal, later Mughals, no, I told the last three Mughals, that Shah Alam I told, no. So Shah Alam from Mughal, and Shuja ud Daula, the Nawab of Awadh. So a three-party alliance, that is your Shuja ud Daula, Nawab of Awadh, and your Mir Qasim from the Nawab of Bengal, and Shah Alam II from Mughal. These tri-party on one side, and the English, okay, that is under Robert Clive, was on the other hand. Okay, this is known as the Battle of Buxar, which led to the Treaty of Allahabad. Your Battle of Plassey ended in the Treaty of Ali Nagar, and Battle of Buxar ended with the Treaty of Allahabad. So what is this Treaty of Allahabad? The tri-party alliance was completely crushed by the British. Okay, so it ended in the Treaty of Allahabad. By this Treaty of Allahabad, Nawab of Awadh, Shuja ud Daula, the whole territory of Awadh was given back to Shuja ud Daula, but Allahabad, places like Allahabad and Kora were taken by British. Okay, that was first, and Shuja ud Daula in turn has to pay some fine of 50 lakh rupees, okay, as war indemnity to the British. That is one thing. And one important thing of the Treaty of Allahabad is, Shah Alam II, the Mughal emperor, gave the Diwani rights, that is the collecting of tax rights of Bengal, Bihar and Orissa to the British. Okay, so this giving of this Diwani rights of Bengal, Bihar and Orissa laid the foundation for the British influence in the Indian territory. Okay, So with this Treaty of Allahabad, two main things. One, which RLM 2 gave the Diwan Heads of Bengal, Bihar and Orissa, and by this Treaty of Allahabad, Shujaud Daula, Awad was given back to Shujaud Daula, taking the places of Allahabad and Kora. Okay, that is the Treaty of Allahabad. Here Treaty of Allahabad, here Treaty of Ali Nagar, Battle of Plassey and Battle of Buxar. Next we are going to the next autonomous states of Mysore. So with respect to Mysore, Anglo-Mysore War. Anglo means the British. Okay, that was a war happening between the British and the Mysore rulers. Okay, so that is a big Anglo-Mysore War. We'll see. So the Anglo-Mysore War. These are the four Anglo-Mysore War. So the first Anglo-Mysore War. So before knowing about the Anglo-Mysore War, what happened with respect to the autonomous state of Mysore? Okay, early in the 18th century, two ministers called Nanjaraj and Devaraj. Okay, they had seized powers from the ruler Chikka Krishna Raja. Okay, that was the beginning of the autonomous state of Mysore. Okay, later an officer called Haider Ali. Haider Ali was actually working as a very clerk level officer. Okay, but later he developed himself and he came to the power of ruler of Mysore. Okay, that is a very interesting story of Haider Ali. Some important facts about Haider Ali is he was born in 1721, and the important thing is he set up an arsenal factory. Arsenal factory means a place where arms will be kept. Okay, he set up an arsenal factory at Dindigul with the help of French experts. Okay, that is with respect to Haider Ali. In the first Anglo-Mysore War, a war between Haider Ali and British, Haider Ali was victorious in the first Anglo-Mysore War, and a treaty was signed, that is Treaty of Madras. Treaty of Madras was signed by this first Anglo-Mysore War. And next, the second Anglo-Mysore War happened. So what led to the second Anglo-Mysore War is the British annexed a territory called Mahe, okay, a French territory within the jurisdiction of Haider Ali. Without asking Haider Ali, they annexed that Mahe, a French settlement. And also by this Treaty of Madras, the British were not following the terms of Treaty of Madras. Okay, that led to this second Anglo-Mysore War. Actually, Haider Ali was forming a tri-party alliance with Nizam of Hyderabad and Marathas, okay, to attack the British. But Warren Hastings, with this clever stroke of diplomacy, made peace with this Nizam of Hyderabad and Marathas, and he retaliated Haider Ali. Okay, actually Haider Ali was defeated by Sir Airey Kotte at Port Nova. Okay, in the year 1781, Haider Ali was defeated, and by 1782, Haider Ali was died of cancer. Okay, so this second Anglo-Mysore War ended with the death of Haider Ali in 1782. Okay. Second Anglo-Mysore War ended with the death of Haider Ali. What was the treaty signed? Treaty of Mangaluru. Treaty of Mangaluru was signed in the second Anglo-Mysore War. Okay. Next came the third Anglo-Mysore War. From this third Anglo-Mysore War, Haider Ali's son Tipu Sultan came into the power. Okay. So some tidbits about Tipu Sultan. Tipu Sultan had interest in French Revolution. He had a great interest in the French Revolution, and he planted Tree of Liberty, and he was also a member of Jacobin Club. Jacobin Club is just a political club during the French Revolution. He was also a member of that time. So he was very much interested in French Revolution. Okay, actually he was also trying to involve the French people and the Turkey people against the British. He was trying to involve them, and he was also very much frustrating the British. Okay, actually he was acquiring the territory of Raja of Travancore. Raja of Travancore was an ally of British, so he was acquiring the territory of Raja of Travancore. This also very much irritated the British. Okay, so finally they wanted to finish this Haider Ali, and then came the third Anglo-Mysore War. Okay, so what was the treaty signed by this third Anglo-Mysore War? Treaty of Srirangapatnam. Treaty of Srirangapatnam was signed by this third Anglo-Mysore War. And they formed a tri-party alliance. Okay, the British formed a tri-party alliance with Nizam of Hyderabad and the Marathas, and they went against this Tipu Sultan. Okay, so finally by this Treaty of Srirangapatnam, Tipu Sultan had to give half of the territory. Okay, half of the territory of Mysuru to the British. Okay, he gave half of territory by this Treaty of Srirangapatnam to the British. Who was the viceroy at that time? Lord Cornwallis. During this third Anglo-Mysore War, Lord Cornwallis was there, and he gave half the territory. Okay, this territory was shared between British and the Nizam of Hyderabad. Okay, so by this fourth Anglo-Mysore War, Tipu Sultan also died. Okay, while defending this capital Srirangapatnam, Tipu Sultan died at the battlefield itself. And after the end of this fourth Anglo-Mysore War, Mysuru fell at the feet of Wellesley, Lord Wellesley at that time. Okay, so Mysuru was also completely annexed by the British. Okay, so that was the end of Mysuru. Okay, these four wars are very important. Treaty is very important. Okay, first Anglo-Mysore War, Treaty of Madras, Treaty of Mangaluru, Treaty of Srirangapatnam, and years just have a rough figure. Okay, because they can ask in a chronological order. Okay, so have a rough understanding of the year. That is with respect to Mysuru. Next we are going to the Punjab. So next is with respect to Punjab. Okay, with respect to Punjab, a ruler is there called Ranjit Singh. Okay, when Ranjit Singh is there, he had a he had an army which is equal to the British strength. He gave a tough fight to the British. So British did not annex Punjab. They didn't interfere in the matters of Punjab till Ranjit Singh was there. But after the death of Ranjit Singh, there was a problem in the navigation of Sutlej. Okay, there was a sharing basis. There was a problem in the navigation of Sutlej that led to the first Sikh war, first Anglo-Sikh war actually, in the year 1845 to 46, first Anglo-Sikh war. Who was the Viceroy at that time? Lord Hardinge. Lord Hardinge was the Viceroy at that time, and Lord Gough was the Commander-in-Chief. Okay, these two, Lord Hardinge and Lord Gough, with a combination, they entered this first Sikh war. And a treaty was signed. Treaty of Lahore was signed by this first Anglo-Sikh war. And by the Treaty of Lahore, British annexed Jalandhar Doh. Okay, a place called Jalandhar Doh was annexed and handed over Jammu and Kashmir. Jammu and Kashmir was handed to the Raja Gulab Singh Dogra. Okay, for a payment of 5 million rupees. Okay, that is the Treaty of Lahore. And what happened is, they placed, okay, by this Treaty of Lahore, Dalip Singh. Okay, Dalip Singh was placed as a ruler and Rani Jindan was placed as his regent. Okay, by this Treaty of Lahore. Okay. Next happened the second Sikh war. So why the second Sikh war happened is, I told, by this Treaty of Lahore, Dalip Singh and Rani Jindan was placed as his regent. Okay, but the British did not treat this Rani Jindan in a good manner. Okay, also there was a revolt of Mulraj. An officer called Mulraj was revolting against the British, and also Sher Singh, an officer called Sher Singh, was sent by the British to suppress that revolt, but unfortunately Sher Singh also joined that revolt and attacked the British. Okay, that led to this second Sikh war. Now came the famous Battle of Gujarat actually. Okay, these all things resulted in this Battle of Gujarat, and by this Battle of Gujarat, whole Punjab was annexed by Dalhousie. Okay, Punjab was annexed by Dalhousie, and this was the last autonomous state that also fell in the feet of British. So all the autonomous state, what I have talked about, that Bengal, Awadh, everything, they became independent, and later on they fell at the feet of British. Why they became independent? Because I told, Mughals were there, later Mughals. Later Mughals were slowly deteriorating. So Marathas were there at the Deccan. Okay, so Marathas had a dream that, okay, we will acquire the whole territory of India, but the invasion of Nadir Shah and Ahmad Shah Abdal did not help that dream to come true. Okay, so when everything was there, when Marathas were not there, when Mughals were not there, slowly the autonomous states got emerged. Okay, but these autonomous states were easily suppressed by the British. Okay, so that is the end of later Mughals and the autonomous states. Okay, next we will be dealing with the European trading companies. So next about the trading companies. Okay, so the first people to come to India is the Portuguese. Okay, by the year 1498, an important personality called Vasco da Gama. Okay, Vasco da Gama entered India through Calicut. Okay, he first landed at Calicut and he was welcomed by a Hindu ruler called Zamorin. Zamorin welcomed Vasco da Gama in the year 1498. So that is the arrival of Portuguese. Okay, so the Portuguese were the first people to come to India. Okay, so in the year 1498. And important governor generals with respect to Portuguese are Francisco de Almeida and Albuquerque. These are the important governor generals with respect to Portuguese. And Albuquerque is related to the capture of Goa from the ruler of Bijapur. That is one extra point here. And what are the things introduced by the Portuguese? Things like potato, tobacco, and red chilies. That were an important introduction by the Portuguese, or the printing press. Okay, so the printing press in India are introduced by the Portuguese. So that is the things related with Portuguese. So what happened to this Portuguese? Why did they fall out? By the Battle of Swali. Okay, the Battle of Swali versus British. In this battle, Portuguese got completely demolished. Okay, so the next people to come to India is the Dutch people. Who are these Dutch? Dutch is the Netherlands people. Netherlands people are known as the Dutch. In the year 1602, okay, 1602, they came to India and they set up factories at Petapuli in North Coromandel and Mosulipatnam, at Karaikal, Nagapatnam and Cochin. Factories were set up at those areas. And what happened to the Dutch? What is the end of the Dutch? By the Battle of Bedara. Okay, Battle of Bedara versus British. In this Battle of Bedara, Dutch were completely crushed. Okay, so the third came the British. Actually, the British were known as the merchant adventurers by the year 1599. But Queen's charter, Queen Elizabeth gave the charter in the year 1600. And from 1600, they made us a trading company. Okay. So here one clarification is there with respect to British. Trading companies were established. Okay. So the British is the first people to set up a trading company. Okay. So a list is there. So this is the list. who established their companies. Okay, these are the Portuguese are the first to come to India, followed by Dutch, British, Danish and French. But setting up of a company, trading company, was first launched by the British, followed by Dutch, Danish, Portuguese and French. So this two lists is very important. This list Hundal come first, and this list Hundal established the trading companies first of all in India. Okay, that is the list, so don't confuse. So the British were the first to form their company in India as for a trading purposes, and they wanted to ask permission. Okay, that permission was given by Jahangir, the Mughal ruler Jahangir gave the permission to Captain Hawkins. Captain Hawkins approached Jahangir and the permission was given for trading. And later on, Aurangzeb also gave some permission, concession was given. Okay, actually to the British, they were exempted from custom duty. That was given by Aurangzeb. So these all encouraged the British to form, to firmly fix the trading companies in India. Okay, actually. And British company factories were set up at Mosulipatnam and Armagyan. They were setting up factories at there. And that with respect to British. Next, the Danish people. Okay, the Denmark people, Danish. So what happened with Danish? They also came to India following British. And the main aim of this Danish, okay, they are not mainly involved in trading. The main aim of this Danish people is for missionary activities. Christianity, related to Christianity, they wanted to convert everyone to Christians. Okay, that was the main activity of the Danish. They also got banished by the years. Okay, so finally they came the French. Okay, actually Danish came in the year 1616. Okay, factories were set up at Trankubar and Serampur. Serampur was in Bengal, was the headquarters of Danish. Okay, so with respect to French, they came at the they are the last people to come to India. First factory was set up at Surat. First factory was set up at Surat by Francois Caron in the year 1668. First factory at Surat by Francois Caron in the year 1668. They acquired Pondicherry in the year 1673. These are the important events with respect to French. And the important governor general with respect to French is Dupleix. Dupleix was important French governor general. Okay. So these are the things with respect to trading companies. And with respect to French and British, a huge tussle was happening that led to the Anglo-Carnatic Wars. Okay, there are many series of Carnatic Wars with respect to British and French. So now we are going to see about the Carnatic Wars. Okay, Carnatic Wars happened between the French and the British people. Okay, so the first Carnatic War, what was the reason? The reason for this happening of first Carnatic War is the Austrian War of Succession. Due to Austrian War of Succession, this first Carnatic War happened. And what are the events related to this first Carnatic War? Arcot Nawab, okay, Arcot Nawab Anwaruddin was defeated in the Battle of Adayar. Okay, so this first Carnatic War ended with the Treaty of Aix-la-Chapelle. Okay, these are the events you should remember with respect to first Carnatic War. The cause was the Austrian Succession. The events happened is Battle of Adayar, Anwaruddin, Nawab of Arcot was attacked, and it ended in the Treaty of Aix-la-Chapelle. Okay, next with second Carnatic War, why this happened is there was a confusion in Hyderabad. Okay, so there was a vacancy in Hyderabad and Arcot, and these people were fighting for the throne. Okay, so Muzaffar Jung and Nasir Jung were fighting for the Nawab of Hyderabad, and Chanda Sahib and Anwaruddin were fighting for the Nawab of Arcot. Okay, so this French people and British people used this opportunity, and this Muzaffar Jung, Hyderabad, and Chanda Sahib, Arcot, was supported by French people, and Nasir Jung and Anwaruddin was supported by the British. Okay, so that was tussle happening between these two groups, and finally this Nasir Jung and Anwaruddin was killed. Okay, they were killed, and Muzaffar Jung and Chanda Sahib was placed on the throne. Okay, so initially French was emerging as victorious, but finally capture of Arcot was captured by Robert Clive in the year 1751. Okay, so the French was again, they were defeated in first Carnatic War also. French was defeated, second Carnatic War also, finally the French was defeated. This led to the Treaty of Pondicherry. Okay, Treaty of Pondicherry, first Carnatic War, Treaty of Aix-la-Chapelle, second Carnatic War, Treaty of Pondicherry. Okay, so next the third Carnatic War. So what led to this third Carnatic War? Capture of Chandranaur, a place called Chandranaur was captured by Robert Clive. Okay, that led to this third Carnatic War. Actually, this third Carnatic War was a long fought battle for 7 years. Okay, so finally this third Carnatic War ended in the Treaty of Paris, and by this third Carnatic War, Battle of Vandivash. Okay, in this Battle of Vandivash, the French were completely defeated. Okay, by this Battle of Vandivash, they were completely defeated, and Treaty of Paris was signed by the British and French people. Okay, So that is with respect to these Carnatic Wars. So the treaty is very important. First Carnatic War with respect to Treaty of Aix-la-Chapelle, second Carnatic War Treaty of Pondicherry, and third Carnatic War Treaty of Paris. Okay. So by this third Carnatic War, Battle of Vandivas and French also completely went. Okay. So this battle are very important. Okay. Portuguese with respect to Battle of Swali, and Dutch people with respect to Battle of Bedara, and French people Battle of Vandivas. In these battles, all were crushed and British were emerging in everything. Okay. They were subjecting every trading companies and they were becoming victorious. And finally, they set a plot for to trade in India. Okay. So next important thing we are going to study is the Vellore Mutiny. An important official called Cradlock. He ordered the Indian soldiers to wear a new turban. That was against the belief of Hindu peoples. That led to the cause of Vellore Mutiny. So what happened is, an important personality called Futeh Haider. Okay, Futeh Haider is the Haider Ali's son. During the marriage of Futeh Haider, all the English soldiers, all the Indian soldiers actually, all the Indian soldiers were planning to revolt against the British. Okay, so one fact to remember here is the 1st Regiment Sepoy named Mustafa Beg. Okay, Mustafa Beg informed the English official Colonel Forbes, but that was not taken very seriously by the British. By this Vellore Mutiny, the Indian soldiers were ready to attack the British, and they attacked actually. Initially, they attacked the British official. The British official were very shocked, okay, because they went for a marriage and they did not realize that they will be attacked by the Indian soldiers, but they attacked, okay. But finally, it was suppressed by an officer called Gillespie, okay. It was suppressed by an officer called Gillespie. So this Vellore Mutiny was not a success one, but initially the Indian soldiers were emerging as success, but finally it was suppressed by the Colonel Gillespie. Okay, so two important official, Cradlock, he is responsible for the cause, and Gillespie suppressed the revolt, and Futeh Haider during the event. Okay, that is with respect to Vellore Mutiny. Next we are going to study about an important revolt, that is the revolt of 1857. Okay. So next about the revolt of 1857. Okay, this is very important in modern day history, because you can ask me a question whether there were any revolt before this revolt of 1857. Definitely, there were many revolts, tribal uprising that were happening. So about those revolts and tribal uprisings, that we have provided as a PDF format with this video. Okay, you can download it and you can view that. It will be in the link provided in this video. Okay, so this revolt of 1857, that is very important, because this revolt of 1857 was a successful one. Okay, for the Indians, it was very successful one, but it was later suppressed. Okay, but it gave a good confidence to the Indians. So this revolt of 1857 becomes very important. So what is the cause we will discuss? What are the cause led to this revolt of 1857? The first cause is about the economic cause. We all know about the economic cause. British were plundering so much with the peasants. Okay, so the peasants got very much aggravated, and they wanted to completely demolish the British. That was the economic point of view cause. Next about the political cause. What are the political cause? They were annexing all the states. British using the policy of subsidiary alliance by Lord Wellesley and doctrine of Lazzi by Dalhousie. By these two policies, they were annexing all the states. Okay, that was also led to the aggravation of the Indian people. And next about the the social cause. What are the social cause? With the effect of Christian missionaries, okay, the Christian missionaries entered India, and they were converting every Hindus to a Christian's one. Okay, that was also an important thing. And with respect to the government's decision, okay, to tax the mosque and temple lands were exempted from tax, but government removed that exemption and they began to collect tax. That was also the social causes. The main cause is the military cause. With respect to military cause, one act is very important. General Service Enlistment Act. By this act, what happened is, before and all, the Indian officials were not made to cross oceans. Okay, they were not made to cross boundaries. But by this act of General Service Enlistment Act, any Indian officer can be placed outside of India or at the boundary of India. Okay, so this was affecting the culture or into the belief of the Hindus actually. Okay, because jumping or moving out of the territory of India is against the belief of Hindus. Okay, they were touching the sentiments of Hindus by this act. And also the important military cause is the greased cartridge. Okay, this is an important military cause and also the immediate cause. Okay, what is this greased cartridge? Actually, it is a bomb like thing, and you should bite that greased cartridge and you should explode that bomb. Okay, so this grease is made up of fat of pig and the chicken. Okay, Hindus were not eating this pig and chicken, so that led to the British also again touched the sentiments of the Hindus. Okay, so these causes revolt. These all causes aggravated and finally resulted in a revolt. That is the famous revolt of 1831. So with respect to this revolt, you should remember the place and the the rulers or at the personalities leading that revolt and the British official who suppressed that revolt. These three is very important. So with respect to Delhi, the old Bahadur Shah was there. Actually, Bahadur Shah is not the real lead at that time. General Bakht Khan, a general called General Bakht Khan, was a real leading the movement. But Bahadur Shah was the emperor. Okay, that with respect to Delhi. With respect to Kanpur, Nana Sahib was the adaptation of Bajrao II. He was leading the revolt at Kanpur, and at Lucknow, Begum of Awadh was leading the revolt, and at Jhansi, Lakshmi Bai was leading the revolt, and at Bihar, Kunwar Singh, a Jamindar called Kunwar Singh was leading the revolt. Okay. These were the leading of the revolt, but finally, who suppressed the revolt? Okay, General Nicholson suppressed the revolt at Delhi, and at Kanpur and Lucknow, Colin Campbell suppressed the revolt, and Hugh Rose, an officer, suppressed the revolt at Jhansi. And what happened to these personalities? These personalities either died or they escaped to other parts of territories of India. Okay, so as I told earlier, revolt of 1857 was initially to a success one, but finally it was suppressed by the British officials. Okay, this revolt of 1857 changed many things, because British were in a mood that the Indian people will not do anything. They were in a mood like that. But by this revolt of 1857, all the Indians united and they attacked the British, and it was a very shocking incident for the British. Okay, so what are the changes after 1857? Many changes happened in the British attitude. Okay, so what are the changes we'll see? So first change is the Queen's Proclamation on November 1858. This Queen's Proclamation. By this Queen's Proclamation, the Indian administration was transferred from the English East India Company trading company to the British Crown. Okay, we all know the British landed in India by 1600, and they set up the trading companies and they were trading. Okay. And finally from the trading they began the next level to administer. Okay, that administration was transferred from this East India Company to the British Crown. Okay, that was the Queen's Proclamation of November 1858, and an important act of 1858 was passed. By this act, two posts, that is the Court of Directors and Board of Control, these two posts were abolished and a new post called Secretary of State was included. Okay, so Charles Wood was the first Secretary of State of India. Okay, that is one extra point here. And the third thing is with respect to army. Okay, with respect to revolt of 1857, the Punjab people, the Sikh people, did not contribute to this revolt of 1857. Okay, so to honor that Sikh people, more people from Punjab, the Sikhs were inducted into the army. Okay, so till now you can see, okay, till now in the Indian army, more number of Sikh people is there. A complete regiment is there for Sikh. And you can see most of the generals will be Sikhs only. Okay, that is the reason, because from the British period, the Punjab people were given more intrusion into the Indian army. That was the main changes after 1858. And also the princely states, also did not support this revolt of 1857. Okay, so after 1858, in all the rules, British will give concession to the princely states to honor their loyalty. Okay, that is the changes after 1858. So with respect to revolt of 1857, main thing is about the cause. Why this happened? That you study about the political cause, economic cause, social cause, and the military cause. Cause is very important. And about the events. In what place? Who are leading the revolt? And about the suppression. Which officer suppressed the revolt? That is very important. And with respect to the changes. What happened in the change of the British attitude? That is also very important. And with respect to the other revolts and tribal uprising, that we have provided in a link below this video. Okay. Next, we are going to see about the Indian National Congress. Okay. That is very, very important. The establishment of Indian National Congress is the next topic. Okay.